The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, you give your children many blessings, even though we are undeserving. In every trial and temptation, grant us steadfast confidence in your loving kindness and mercy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Reading from the Book of Concord, the Formula of Concord, Article 11, God's Eternal Foreknowledge and Election. Christ calls all sinners to himself and promises them rest. He is eager that all people should come to him and allow themselves to be helped. He offers them himself in his word and wants them to hear it and not to plug their ears or neglect and despise the word. Furthermore, he promises the power and working of the Holy Spirit and divine assistance for the perseverance and eternal salvation so that we may remain steadfast in the faith and gain eternal salvation.
Our Old Testament lesson today is from Isaiah chapter 56. Thus says the Lord, keep justice and do righteousness, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance be revealed. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants, everyone who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it, and holds fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. The Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel, declares, I will gather yet others to him besides those already gathered. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Fear the Lord, you his saints. Many are the afflictions of the righteous,
but the Lord delivers them.
Our epistle lesson is from Romans chapter 11. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means, for I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. Now I am speaking to you Gentiles. Inasmuch then as I am an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry in order somehow to make my fellow Jews jealous and thus save some of them. For if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? As regards the gospel, they are enemies of God for your sake. But as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers, for the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were at one time disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, so they too have now been disobedient in order that by the mercy shown to you, they also may now receive mercy. For God has consigned all to disobedience, that he may have mercy on all. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 15th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus went away from there and withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and was crying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely oppressed by a demon." But he did not answer her a word. And his disciples came and begged him, saying, "Send her away, for she is crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "O woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. At this time, I invite forward any children for a children's message.
Have a seat right there. Yep, let's sit down right there. All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you guys for coming down to talk to me. Well, I first want to ask you, has there ever been a toy, something that you really, really wanted? Maybe a Lego set, maybe a doll, maybe a game of some sort, a video game, something you really, really want. Has that happened before? So you ask mom and dad and you say, "Can I have that for my birthday?" Yeah, and you hope you get it for your birthday, and then you don't get it for your birthday. So what do? I think something you do might be, you get money, you buy it yourself. Yeah, maybe. I think something you might do is ask for it again. Maybe Christmas comes around, you didn't get it at your birthday, so now you ask for it at Christmas. "I really, really want that Lego set or that game." So you ask for it again and maybe you'll get it at Christmas, right? Maybe. You know, I will tell you, sometimes the things we ask for, sometimes we get them, and sometimes we don't. And when it comes to a toy or something like that you may want, mom or dad know what's best, and they give you, sometimes they give you things, and sometimes you don't get the thing you want. But I want to tell you about a little bit about the gospel lesson today. There was a woman who came to Jesus, and she asked him for something. There was something she really, really wanted. Her daughter needed to be healed. And Jesus didn't answer her. He didn't say no, but he didn't say yes. He didn't answer her. So she asked again and again. She kept asking. And you know what Jesus eventually then did? What Jesus said? He answered her. He said, "I'll give you what you want." And her daughter was healed. So even though there's maybe things in life like a toy of some sort or a game or a Lego set that we want and we really, really want, maybe we get it, maybe we don't. But there are some things you can ask God for, and he will always listen and always answer. I want to teach you guys a very short but very important and powerful prayer. Is that okay? Can I do that? It's called the Kyrie. That's a fancy name, but it's "Lord, have mercy." Can you guys say that with me? "Lord, have mercy." Very good. We pray that in church all the time, and it's again in our gospel lesson. This Canaanite woman prayed that to Jesus, and when we pray that to Jesus, he listens and he always answers. Sooner or later, he always answers. It doesn't mean he gives us exactly what we want, but he will give us an answer and help us. "Lord, have mercy." We say that all the time. So you can say it over and over and over again. Jesus doesn't mind being pestered. You can pester him all you want, and he'll always listen and answer. So if we are in need of something, if there's something you want, like the most important thing is you feel bad about something you did, a sin, and you want to be forgiven. Or maybe you're upset about something, or you're sad about something, or you're scared of something. Whatever happens, whatever it is you need, you can simply pray, Lord, have mercy. And Jesus will hear and he will answer. Can you guys pray that again with me? Say it. Ready? Lord, have mercy. Very good. It's very short, but it's a wonderful prayer. And we've already prayed it here in church, and we're going to pray it some more in church too. Okay? So just remember, when you ask for something, if you don't get it, you can ask again. And mom or dad may or may not give it to you. They know what's best. Sometimes they give you something and sometimes they don't. But you can always ask Jesus, Lord, have mercy, and he will help you. He will always help you, okay? All right, thank you guys for coming up. You can each have one of my lifesavers and go back to your seats. Thank you, guys. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. Have you ever wondered what faith looks like? Well, obviously you can't see faith, just like you can't see the air. But you can see the results of faith, the characteristics of faith, just like you can see the characteristics of air, such as when air fills a balloon, or when a breeze ruffles the leaves on a tree. Our gospel lesson today shows us the characteristics of faith. Through this Canaanite woman that comes to Jesus, we can better understand what faith looks like. Jesus uses her in this whole event to show us some of the key characteristics of faith. Three of them. Three key characteristics of faith are humility, persistence, and contentment. Humility, persistence, and contentment. Now we're going to look at these three by going through the gospel lesson, kind of Bible study style. That's the style of this particular sermon. So if you want to follow along, you certainly can. First of all, humility. The first couple of verses of our gospel lesson. Jesus went away from there and withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and was crying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely oppressed by a demon." Now this Canaanite woman, a foreigner, approaches Jesus. And first of all, you have to understand the animosity between the Jews and all the foreigners around them. Many of you know this. The Jews did not get along with the Canaanites or the Samaritans or any of the other foreigners. So it took a great deal of humility on the part of this Canaanite woman for her to approach Jesus. Then, when she does approach him, she cries out, "Have mercy on me, O Lord." She's begging. Have you ever begged for something? Now, yes, certainly I can say children maybe beg for candy or video games. I'm sure I myself did that at a certain age as well. But can you think of a time where you begged for something, something you had no right to, you didn't deserve, but yet you pleaded for it? Maybe you're speeding and you get caught. And you ask the policeman, "Can you please just let me off?" Yeah, that actually happened to me just this summer with my whole family in the car. Well, I realized afterwards I was begging to be let off. He actually did let me off. Even in times when we may be truly in need, any of us, in need of money, or in need of companionship, or in need of emotional support, or simply with help around the house that we are in need. Even in those times of need for each of us, quite often our inflated American ego prevents us from begging. We don't want to ask for help, do we? We would rather struggle on our own than admit that we need help. We would rather go out and buy that extra tool than ask a neighbor to come over and help you. We would rather struggle on our own with homework or housework or chores than simply admit we need help. You see, we think in our own minds, we think if you beg for something, if you ask for help, it's a sign you can't take care of it yourself. And we view that as defeat. We, in our human nature, are much too proud for that. Your human nature is filled with pride and unwilling to admit you can't do it on your own. But that is the reality. You can't. This Canaanite woman shows us the humility that is required of faith. And that's what we need to do. She comes to Jesus in humility and begs, "Have mercy on me, O Lord." Now, yes, it's the same as the Kyrie. I looked it up in the Greek. The same words, just in reverse order. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on me, O Lord. We need to admit to God and to ourselves that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. If you don't admit that, how can God help you? Yes, we need to admit we need help. We need help from each other for earthly things, and we need help from God for spiritual things. And I believe that's one reason that God brings us together as families, as communities, as a church, is so that we can help one another. We help others and they help us when we are in need. If you are in need of anything, just simply and humbly ask. The Canaanite woman was humble. And when you pray the Kyrie, you are showing that your faith is humble. And you are recognizing you can't do it on your own, whatever it is. And you are asking the Lord for help. Lord, have mercy. Now, if you finally build up the courage and in humility ask for help, what is the worst answer that you could receive? Well, I would say the worst answer you can get is silence, a non-answer. Our next verse in our gospel lesson, but Jesus did not answer her a word. And his disciples came and begged him, saying, "Send her away, for she is crying out after us." One of the biggest fears that the Israelites had in the Old Testament was that God would be silent to them. They would rather be chastised, they would rather receive a no answer than receive the silent treatment. You heard a little bit about this attitude of the Old Testament in our introit, the psalm, where they're crying out for God's answer. So, why is Jesus silent? He knows that's what they fear the most. Throughout the Gospels, Jesus is compassionate. He's quick to heal. He's quick to cast out, raise the dead, forgive, do all those compassionate things. And yet here, he is silent. Why? Jesus is doing this to strengthen this woman in her patience, in her persistence, to strengthen her in faith, and to use her to show us that faith is persistent. When Jesus was silent, she continued pleading with him. She was persistent to the point of becoming annoying. The disciples protested to Jesus, "Send her away! She's pestering us! She's bothering us, Jesus! Send her away!" And yet, what does God tell all of us? He says to pray in all circumstances and to pray without ceasing. You see, by doing that, God helps you learn patience and persistence and to grow stronger in your faith. If you have some request from God, whether it's something big like a life-threatening disease or something small and annoying like a rash, go ahead and cry out to God continuously. He will listen and he will answer you sooner or later. So point number two is for us to learn that faith is persistent. And because of her persistence, Jesus answered. The last few verses, Jesus says, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." Another variation of the Kyrie. And Jesus answered, "It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Humility, persistence, and now, contentment. Contentment with whatever Jesus decides to give her. She recognizes that the smallest crumb from the Lord's table is more important than all the bread of this world. She is content with the smallest bit of help from Jesus, a mere crumb of his help. I think she could claim, along with King David in Psalm 84, "I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God, a small position on the fringes of God's kingdom, than dwell in the tents of the wicked." It is better to have a small portion of God's help than to dwell in the tents of the unrighteous.
This Canaanite woman is content with whatever level of mercy Jesus will show her. Humility, persistence, and contentment. This is a recipe for prayer, right there. Have mercy on me, O Lord. Or, Lord, have mercy. A powerful prayer that exhibits humility, persistence, and contentment. We too, as God's people, we should be humble in our prayers, repenting of our sins and begging God for forgiveness and help. We too should be persistent, praying over and over again, pray without ceasing for all things. We too should be content in our prayers, thankful for whatever blessings God has given us, and content with whatever answers and level of mercy he may give to you, knowing that he has your best interest in mind in all things. So pray. Pray in humility, persistence, and contentment. Pray in faith, and Christ will answer. You see, he knows what it's like to get the silent treatment, to not get an answer. Jesus knows. He cried out from the cross, and he didn't get an answer. He got the silent treatment, forsaken by God the Father in the midst of the worst possible situation, hanging to death on a cross. And because Jesus endured that situation and being forsaken by God the Father, you never have to. Jesus will never forsake you. He is always listening, and he will answer. He will answer with the best answer for you when we pray in humility, persistence, and contentment. Yes, call out to Jesus, Lord, have mercy, knowing that he has your best interests in mind and will give you the most wonderful of answers that is appropriate for you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds in the one true faith, in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We now have the great opportunity of joining together in unity, confessing our faith publicly by using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, at this time, very briefly, I'd like to dedicate the new crosses that are outside on the hill. So if you'll follow along with me. Beloved in the Lord, St. Paul speaks of the importance of the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ
saying this in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, "When I came to you, brothers, I did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. By his death on the cross, our Lord won salvation for us. It is fitting that these crosses be sanctified by the word of God and prayer for our devotion and as a proclamation of Christ's atoning work for us." Let us pray. Merciful and everlasting God, you did not spare your only Son, but delivered him up for us, that he might bear our sins on the cross. Grant that our eyes may ever behold our Savior and his cross, that we may not fear the power of any adversaries, but rather rejoice in Jesus' victory for us. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, we ask that you would bless these crosses that have been placed on our hill outside our church, that the message of salvation through your Son's suffering on the cross may be proclaimed continuously to us and throughout our community. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with the prayers of the church. If you are able, please rise for prayer. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Let us pray. O Lord, bless this congregation and this church. Grant that it may be a house of prayer and that we would be a people of prayer. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. O Lord, grant that the church may steadfastly proclaim your irrevocable gifts. We pray for your blessing upon all those who publicly proclaim your gospel. We ask for your blessing upon our pastor, our principal and teachers, our church workers, and our missionaries, including Reverend Dr. Christian and Lula Tuz in Germany, and Deaconess Caitlin Warden de Ramirez in Peru. Grant that all those who hear your gospel would become grafted onto Jesus Christ, the true vine. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would strengthen the faith of all your people here on earth. Especially we pray for this congregation, all of our members, all those gathered here today, and especially this day we pray for Scott Streffling and family, Joyce Totsky, Savannah Ulmer, Tom and Lori Ulmer, Ron and Karen Vandermeer, and Ken Virgi. Encourage us all through the words that your Son, Jesus, has died for our sins and risen again. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. O Lord, bless all honest work and occupations, and grant that we may use well the fruits of our labors. Give us generosity for all those who are in need. Bless the tithes and offerings that accompany our sacrifice of praise. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. O Lord, grant that the government and those who protect us might preserve justice and do righteousness for your name's sake. We pray especially, Lord, that you would be with all those who serve us in the government, those who serve us in our community, and those who serve us in the military, including Allison Blake, Luke Whitman, James Virgi, Joseph Schaefer, Matt Weiss, and Anna Dinsmore. We pray that you would continue to use them and give them courage and wisdom to do your will. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. O Lord, care, we pray, for all those who cry out to you, whether beset with grief or sorrow, pain or trouble in life. We especially lift before you this day Allie Wallace, Amanda Clark, Amy Manti, Ava Sandman, Barbara Mall, Barb Rogers, Bob Dixon, Carol Bonskowski, Carol Matheny, Connie Schwanger, Dave Knuth, Don Jeske, Faith Tim, Bernie Rance, Fred Knuth, Jenny and Charlotte Hunt, Joseph Klupp, Ken Virgi, Margaret Gerber, Miro Versick, Nancy Duke, Nathan Gerken, Scott Dine, Stacy Scarupa, and Susan Jackemeyer. We also pray for Ann Rausch, Austin Arndt, Brian Bailey, Kate Reed, Chris Watson, Chris Gerlach, Christian Myers, David Ware, Aaron Sage, Jenna Vine, John Trotsky, Joe Lotka, Carol Searing, Ken Gotch, Kyle Bonskowski, Les Lamar, Liam Pugh, Lisa Daring, Lynn Beasley, Nancy Gerald, Nathan Tim, Robert White, Ron Cevada, Sherry Orchard, and Veronica Wilkinson. Grant them all, Heavenly Father, health and healing and peace of mind according to your will. Be pleased, for Christ's sake, to answer them with what they need. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. O Lord, we pray that you would keep safe all those who are in harm's way of the coming hurricane that is hitting the West Coast. Keep them safe, give them courage, and grant them the wisdom to do what is necessary to keep themselves safe. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant to us, dear Father, for the sake of your Son who died and rose again and taught us to pray. Our Father. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.